Correct. What I'm saying is that data frame is one usage model which works with people like me, but there is lots of application, especially if it is written in billion words,
right?
Then you would want a streaming model.
In that case, you just need to
Hi, I'm Nishanth. I'm going to talk about MySQL.jl. MySQL.jl is a Julia package which lets you execute SQL commands from Julia. So the objective here is to talk about three things. MySQL.jl usage. It's a really simple API. There's not much to talk about it. So I thought of adding a little bit about its implementation and some things that might not be really talked about in the Julia world. So the thing, second thing I'm going to talk about is the Julia C interface. So and the last thing I'm going to close with is improving performance. So you might think why you would want to bother with the Julia C interface as say a data scientist or someone working at the higher level. I think there's a lot of code already written in C over the decades. And this Julia C interface lets you call Julia or get data from Julia and get it as, I'm going to talk about how to get it as a Julia data structure, like say an array. So I think that's a useful thing to know because you can write packages in a few lines of code that do a lot of things by just calling Julia. This is a basic API of MySQL.jl. There are some more functions which I'm not going to talk about just for the interest of time. So you include the package by saying using MySQL, and you connect by saying MySQL connect followed by the IP address, the usual thing, username, password, and DB name. And it returns to you a MySQL context which you can use in your other MySQL function. So this wrapper, a handy wrapper called MySQL execute query. It pretty much does everything that you need it. Like if you pass it a select statement, it returns a data frame. If you pass it some, say, an update statement, it'll tell you how many affected rows you've affected. Suppose you don't want the output to be a data frame, you can specify it with the third argument saying MySQL array, and you get it as an array of arrays. Like this. You can also go through each row of the table using an iterator, using a for loop like this. So you say MySQL row iterator and you pass it the result and you'll print each, I'm printing each row here, I'm iterating through each row and printing. The MySQL APIs that I've written, I have not really put an error check because that would be like an overhead, like if you're calling it say 10,000 times or something. But if you want to check whether, if you want to check for error, you call MySQL display error and you pass it the response that is given back by any of the MySQL APIs. And this error you see here, that's from MySQL, not from Julia. The rest is a status or whatever from Julia, but that is from MySQL, saying that some table doesn't exist. And you disconnect by saying MySQL disconnect. So that's the basic API. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about the Julia C interface. I think the Julia C interface is really simple and easy to use. So we'll see. Suppose you have a C function. This is MySQL query in C. And I had to write a wrapper for this in Julia. So a function has three parts. It has a name, it has a return type, and it has some arguments. So how would I write this in Julia? How would I call this in Julia? It's really simple. So there's a C function there, and the Julia code is here. So if you keep looking back and forth, you'll see this is a return type here. The arguments are here. And the function name is here. But you have to also tell from which library you got that function name. So there's a string here. This is actually a string. It's assigned to a variable. And it's basically MySQL. And then you pass it the arguments. So this becomes a wrapper. So now you...
Okay.
maybe this isn't the most simplest and best example. I should have just shown printf or something, but I wanted to show something from the MySQL code itself. So, okay, so that's about functions. Now, how do you deal with C data types? Like you have C data, and you want to read it as, say, a Julia array. You want Julia to understand it, or you want the other way around. You have some Julia data, and you want C to understand it. So, let's say you have something like this. It's a simple pointer to a pointer in C. So, it's basically saying, this name here should represent this. Char star star. And that's MySQL role. Like, that's how each row in MySQL is returned, actually. So, in Julia, that would be simple. Just replace the stars with pointer. And typeF becomes type alias, and you have MySQL row, pointer, pointer, and C char. It's as simple as that. If you have a struct like this, what do you do? Okay, we'll just see it. So, if you keep looking back and forth, you'll see a pattern, right? So you'll see that a point star becomes pointer, and we've already and it's a pointer to itself. So you have the same thing there, and then we've just declared this there in that type alias thing, and then unsigned long becomes C U long. So in the same way, like float becomes C float, double becomes C double, int becomes C int, unsigned int becomes C U int, so on. So I have a bunch of like question answer kind of things, so just see them quickly. So let's see, now a C function gave me a pointer. How do I get a Julia array from it? It's a pointer, right? So an array in C is a pointer. How do I get a Julia array from it? So I have a pointer here. That's a C pointer, like a 64-bit integer. So all I have to do is say pointer to array, and then I have to give the length. So C just gives you a pointer, and usually the C APIs give you a length, unless you're getting a string which is null terminated. If you're getting a bunch of numbers, you need to know the length. So this pointer gave me back a Julia array, and it's 1, 2, 3. It's just an array of 1, 2, 3. Another question: how do I do the reverse? How do I go from how do I get a C pointer from a Julia array? I have a Julia array. How do I get C pointer? This is really simple. All you have to do is call pointer under array. That's it. Pointer A. That's it. So this is just an example from the MySQL code. So this C call here, this has a C call inside of it, and it requires a pointer to the MySQL bind. It's going to bind the results there. It's going to put the results there. So this is how the prepared statements work. So what I'm doing is I'm just calling pointer, and that's it. Just pass it there, and it works. Okay, another question. C gave me a pointer of type void. How do I get a floating point value from it? So C uses void for its genericness or whatever, point to anything. So this is a void pointer. All I have to say is reinterpret. That's like a very well named function. Say reinterpret pointer float, and I get a float pointer. Okay, so I now have a float pointer. How do I get a float value from it? I say unsay float. Unsay float is like saying star variable in C, like dereferencing. So any dereferencing in C is unsafe. So this is not like a limitation or anything. It's just saying that it's unsafe. So Julia won't know about it in a way. Okay, this is something else. This is actually from the I just found this interesting, so I just put this here. This is from the Modbus while I was working on Modbus. So, which you just saw, the device thing and the plotting thing. So, the API there, it gives you a floating point number, but it gives it to you like this. It just gives you bits. It just gives you an unsigned bit. How do you get that into a floating point number, right? So, if I just say float of that, it's just going to, if this was 12, and if I say float of that, it's going to give me 12.0, that's it. I don't want that. I want it to be decoded into a floating point number. So how do I do that in Julia? It's really simple. All I say is reinterpret, it's C float and that number, and it gives me 3.14. That's 3.14 in the IEEE format in binary if you convert it to bits. Okay, the last one. So you know how C frees memory, right? So C frees memory, C doesn't free memory, it doesn't have a GC, a garbage collector. You have to free it yourself. So, if a C call you called allocated some memory, Julia doesn't know about it. So, how will Julia garbage credit. It won't actually. But you can make it garbage credit. You don't have to free it yourself. So the way to do it is, it's really simple. Although this looks a little big, but it's really simple. You call finalizer and you pass it. This is a variable to which you've assigned whatever you've allocated. And you say, when Julia is going to garbage collect this, also call this. Also call this C call. So this is freeing this result. So I can't just wait C call because that will be like called instantly. I don't want to call it now. I want to call it, this is basically a syntax for an anonymous function, this arrow thing. So I want to call it when the GC kicks in. The GC kicks in and says, oh, result is out of scope, you're no longer using it, I'm going to clean it up. So while cleaning it up, also call this so that whatever memory C has allocated clears out. Okay, that's all. I'm just going to quickly go over performance. Why performance first of all? So what we usually do, what some software developers usually do is make a prototype in Ruby or Python and then decide it's too slow and then make the production version like say C++ because it's faster, the type is more static or whatever. So how to deal with performance? Okay, how much time do I have? 3 minutes, okay. Okay, I'll just finish this here. So when you're dealing with performance, the first question you have to ask is, what should I improve? Like, what parts of my code are taking the most amount of time? How do you find out which part of my code is taking the most amount of time? So there are tools for doing this. There's the macro add time, this profile view, and then this lint. I'm just going to show some screenshots about that. So if this MySQL SQL query, when you pass it like a small table like this, it actually does some work converting it into a data frame, and that's the thing that takes time, and that's what we're trying to optimize. So what we did is we gave it like a 10,000 row array because performance, like, it's most effective at scale, right? So at scale we found like it took some 5 seconds or something, and then we looked into where we could improve, and I'm going to show you how to improve that. I'm going to get to that. So basically add time gives you time, it gives you how much memory is allocated, and over here it'll tell you how much GC has happened. Here no GC is happening because we've removed all that. But it'll tell you, if you have a 20% GC then you're doing really bad. This is another tool called profile view. Each color represents a function. This function is calling, this function is calling, this function is calling, that way, like a stack. And the horizontal length represents how much time it took. And if you hover your mouse over it, actually it's a big image showing all the functions in your code, but I just showed a screenshot so that you can see the mouse pointer. And it's telling which function this thing represents. Lint is a tool, it just shows you like how bad of a programmer you are, I guess. So it just tells you, like if you see here, I'm assigning a 64-bit lint value to an unsigned lint 8, which could potentially be a big bug. So it finds out problems like this. And this is like typical of what GCC would send you. Like it will tell you, do you have a variable iter, you've not even used it that way. So, okay, how to make code faster? Just like, say 1 minute on this. A simple tip, just use const in front of your global variables, it will make it faster. Another tip is, so Julia has concrete types and it has abstract types. Abstract types are like polymorphisms, like decided at runtime, right? And that takes more time. So if you know the type beforehand, you can mention it to Julia. You don't have to say, I could write any here, and I could say array of any, but if I give it a concrete type like this, it will work faster. Plus, you can also initialize memory for the array. How long do you want the array to be? Instead of pushing to an array like as if it was a queue, right? And another thing, what is this? So here, I'm just saying, assign to this a zero of type this. Because if I just say zero, assign a basic int zero to it, and somewhere I assign a uint and the type changes. So one tip is avoid changing types in Julia. So if you want to avoid changing types, you have to write things like this. I showed a link earlier, you can just Google performance tips in Julia and it'll take you to the read the docs page, and there you can read more about this. Preallocation type, okay, I spoke about all that. Okay, in conclusion, although this was a MySQL talk, but the conclusion is not related to that. The conclusion is, in Julia you can do high-level programming, you can do data science and all that stuff. Everyone knows about that. But also what you can do is you can interact easily with C, and you can improve performance without having to re-implement your code in a lower level language. That's all. Thank you. Questions?
We'll take one question where the next speaker sets up who's not on the list. But yeah, so questions?
So you talked about specifying the type, right?
Yeah.
So for functions which do multiple dispatch, is there a performance impact if you specify the type or not?
When you do multiple specific dispatch, you usually mention the type, right? If you've written the function once and you want it to...
No. When you write the function, if I don't declare the type of the arguments,
okay.
Does it is when it does the multiple dispatch, it figures out the types that are given that it is compiled.
If inference happens at compile time,
at compile.
Yeah.
No, so there is.
It's no. It's not slower.
It's not slower.
It's not slower.
Okay. Great.
All right. Thanks, Nishanth.